Hey everyone, my name is Jason with Mount Baker Mining and Metals, and on today's video, we're going to continue my never-ending quest, it seems like, for the best recipe for smelting down gold concentrates. And so we're going to be working with these sulfides here, and we're going to do a series of experiments to test the efficiency and effectiveness of sodium carbonate versus sodium hydroxide. All right, well, bear with me through a little back-of-the-napkin math here. So sodium hydroxide and sodium carbonate, upon heating, both break down into the same compound that we want, the sodium oxide here, this Na2O. They do that in a couple different ways and release different byproducts. The sodium hydroxide releases water. The sodium carbonate releases CO2. Now, there's a couple of different advantages if we can get this sodium hydroxide to work. One, to get the same amount of sodium oxide at the end of the heating reaction, we can use less material. We can use 80 grams, use 2 moles of it, but the total weight is 80 grams versus 106 for the sodium carbonate. And so we can use less material, less flux in our crucible, which means we can add more sulfides in there and get more efficiency with our smelts. The second one is that the lye or sodium hydroxide melts at a much lower temperature. And when it releases this water as a gas, it comes off and it doesn't froth and foam and spit all over the furnace. Whereas with the sodium carbonate, it melts at a very high temperature and this CO2 comes off and it forms a really frothy, foamy mess. And sometimes it can boil over in the crucible. So I want to test sodium hydroxide as a flux component, but I want to make sure we don't lose our recovery by doing so, hence the test today. All right, so let's go over our methods here. We're going to use 2 crucibles, and I'm going to reuse them for the same tests. I'm going to use 1 for 3 different smelts of the sodium hydroxide, and I'm going to use the other 1 for 3 different smelts of the sodium carbonate. Now, for our flux, we're going to use 100 grams of the sulfides here. For the sodium hydroxide, I'm going to add 80 grams of sodium hydroxide. For the soda ash, I'm going to add 100 grams because that molar weight difference there, we're going to end up with the same amount of sodium oxide, but we need to add different amounts for each one. And then I'm going to add 25 grams of silica to both. I'm going to add 25 grams of oxidizer to both, potassium nitrate. I'm going to add 100 grams of lead at the very bottom of the crucible for each test. And then as we pour, I'm going to recycle that lead for the next 2 other tests and keeping the lead prills separate, obviously. The last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add iron in the form of nails. I'm going to use new nails every time. I'm going to add 5 8-penny nails to each smelt, but I'm going to do that after the smelt has completed and is calmed down, the reactions are finished. I don't want the oxidizer to eat up the iron. I want that to work on the sulfides and some of the other stuff in there. So we're going to add the iron at the very end. And what the iron does, it creates the sulfide FeS, which then is going to be soluble in our sodium oxide rich slag. Here's our sample all mixed up. I'm going to add it to our crucible with the 100 grams of lead in the bottom as our collector metal. Make sure I don't spill any. There we go. Now I'll do that 3 more times with that same recipe. And I'll do it 3 times in this crucible with the same recipe except for adding sodium hydroxide instead of sodium carbonate. Now we'll take our first lead prill over to the cupelling furnace, and it's heated up to about 1800 degrees Fahrenheit. We'll put the prill in the cupel, and as the lead melts and comes up to temperature, the lead oxide that is formed rolls off the lead button, molten button, and is absorbed into that cupel. And this process continues until only a little bead of precious metals is left. Here's our third and final lye sample. Sodium hydroxide. The sodium carbonate sample's in the furnace right now. There we go. Separates really nice from the lead or from the slag. All these have. The slag is a little bit stony in color. I think there's a little bit of silica in the concentrates there. So it probably isn't as basic as our calculations would have you think. But there's our lead button. Again, that's been recycled 3 times through the smelting process. Seems like every time it loses about 3 grams. So it should weigh about 90 or 91 grams. And 89, yep, so right about on track. So once that other one is done in the cupelling furnace, I'll get this one in there, and then we can compare the bead sizes. All right, we'll check on our first one here. There you go, it's in there, it's getting smaller. So I'll let that one go a little bit, and then we'll put the next one in. Let's check on our bead here. This is from the soda ash sample. Oh yeah, it's done. Oh, it's tiny. So there's that little bead from the soda ash sample. And people ask me, can I reuse these cupels? Typically not, but where it's not black, there's more holding capacity for lead. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take out that little bead, put this lead right in there, and reuse that one.
And a lot of people have asked, how long does it take to cupel? The 100 grams we did takes about 45 to 60 minutes in the furnace. So that's right around 2 grams per minute, roughly.
Well, let's get our little bead here and get this thing weighed up. This is again from the soda ash sample. 0.059, 0.058, 0.059. And looking at that thing, it is really silvery. It's at least 50% silver by weight, if not more. Too bad it's such a little button.
So I should mention real quick, I got these sulfides off the number 2 off the shaker table. And this is from a sample I did a couple weeks ago. And the number 1 had quite a bit of gold and silver in it. And so I was hoping that The owner said that there was going to be some quite a bit of silver and gold in the sulfides just in general. So I was hoping that we'd have quite a bit of gold and silver in this stuff, but turns out that's not the case. So I haven't done the second button yet. I don't know what that's going to be, but I was hoping to get a few 2, 3, 4 grams worth of precious metals, and that would give us kind of a better spread. But when you're dealing with 0.0xx grams, that's pretty small for what we're trying to do here. But we ran the test. Let's see what it turns out to be like, and it'll give us something to shoot for or some idea for going forward.
All right, let's check out our second bead here. This is the one with the lye, or the sodium hydroxide. Also very small.
All right, here's the first one we did with the soda ash. That was 0.059 grams. Here's the one with the lye. 0.062. So almost exactly the same. Here's a quick little sample calculation with our first bead. That's how much it weighed. We did a total of 300 grams, which is 0.3 kilograms. When you convert that into tons, it would take 333,333 samples to make 1 ton. So when you multiply that by that number, it worked out to be right around 200 grams per metric ton of precious metals. Well, there's our results. They came in within 5% of each other. It's too bad the beads were so small, because what I was hoping to do is have a couple 2 or 3 grams worth that we could really see some variation. But even with this small sample and 300 grams of fairly low-grade concentrates, it came out kind of right in line with each other. So maybe it doesn't matter if you use lye, sodium hydroxide, or sodium carbonate. So not quite the results I was looking for or I was thinking. My thought was, and I've done some tests in the past where I thought I remembered, and that's why it's important for me to get all this on video, that the lye was significantly less recovery than the soda ash. So, but this test kind of concludes that they're both about the same. I may redo this one, and I actually had saved out some slag from each sample I was going to send off for assay. But I don't know if this is exactly representative of what I wanted. So I may redo this one in the future when I have some concentrates that I know have some precious metals in them, and we can look at the difference between the lye and the soda ash. So I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.